Mr. Chairman, dear colleagues, good morning. First of all, I would like to thank the Executive Committee and Professor Costantinidis to invite me in this session on vasculitis. And I will start on this topic that is really chronic rhinosinusitis, or I'm missing something. And when we look at patients like this one with an alteration of the mucociliary transport with edema, the patient is referring nasal obstruction, headache, or sinusitis, or we can see a crusting with a destruction, or we can see something more, a bigger destruction with some sign of crusting, ulcering of the mucosa, or worse, like this, where you have common rheumatological features with the destruction of columella, destruction of the palate, but with different diagnoses. GPA in the first two panels, CMDL, sarcoidosis, IgG4-related disease, and CMDL again. So there are some common rhinological features like epistasis, nasal crusting, midline destructive lesions, nasal paranasal granuloma, nasal deformity, and the differential diagnosis might be very difficult. A bit less between lymphomas, infectious disease, non-granular mucositis immune diseases, and toxic exposure, but is really complicated sometimes with GPA, IgG4-related disease, and with CIMDL. I will speak in this presentation, in these few minutes that we have together, about the cocaine problem, so the CIMDL, because if you look at the epidemiology, as you can see here, the cannabis is really still use a lot, but also cocaine. If you look in Europe, there are in the population between 15 and 64 years, about 4 million people that has used it in the last year, and about 8 million people that use in the lifetime. But if you consider population between 15 and 34, in the last year, the use was about 3 million. And if you look here, the share of the drug use in the European Union, we look at cannabis is still the first, but cocaine in the lifetime represent the 5.4%, and in the last year, the 1.3%. And when we look at the cocaine residues in the wastewater in selected European cities, like Valencia, Barcelona, Milano, Paris, Bordeaux, London, and we see that there is still a very important amount of people that are using cocaine. And as we can see here in this graph, Spain, France, Great Britain, but also Italy, and also the northern country has still big problem with cocaine. And we start the road on the cocaine patient in 2001 when I was working in Brescia with Professor Nicolai, and we were able to identify a clinical, radiographic, histopathologic, and serologic features and their differentiation from GPA. Then with the Mayo Clinic with Professor Speck, we were delineating a particular kind of IANCA. And then we discover apoptosis. Then we try to describe a cocaine-induced midline destructive lesion like an autoimmune disease. And now we have arrived to a genetic approach and analysis of patient with CIMDL. We are interested in this problem because, as you can see here, the destruction sometimes is really terrible. If you look at this patient in 1996, there is a destruction of the columella, and after 4 years, there is a complete destruction. This is a prosthesis, and if you look here with an endoscope through the mouth, a huge palate perforation in 1996, and the MR, destruction of the hard palate and of the inferior middle superior turbinate, and 4 years later, you can see with an endoscope through the mouth, a huge anterior skull base encephalocele, as you can see here at the MR in the coronal plane. As you see here, the encephalocele and the nose is a very big hole. And the lateral wall of the nose is the lateral wall maxillary sinus, the floor is the thumb, and the roof is represented by encephalocele. If you look here, another patient that has been treated for 2 years for a GPA, because it was denying the use of cocaine. And as you see here, there is a huge palate perforation, a nasocutaneous fistulas, and here is also the MR, destruction inferior middle superior turbinates. Here are other example of patients, and this patient was very young. She was 18 years when she developed the hard palate perforation, and also here a soft palate perforation, and here a huge palate perforation. Here other example of palate perforation through the mouth and with the 30 degree optic through the nose. Here is a destruction of the columella that was really a challenge for us, because at the beginning we were afraid that the patient could have a lymphoma, but at the end he was a cocaine lesion, very important destruction of the columella. And here the same, after 6 years the patient developed this destruction. Sometimes happen to collapse the nose. We have a saddle nose that is similar to the saddle nose we could find several years ago with the GPA patient. You can see on the lateral view, and you can see here the nose cutaneous fistula. Here there is a destruction also of the clivus, as you can see here in these coronal images with a CT scan. And this patient, after 6-7 years, developed from the hole of the soft palate a bigger hole, including also the hard palate. Here is what generally make you arouse the suspicions of the use of cocaine. When you see the destruction, but you see the mucosa that is a bit yellow and brownish with some ulcers. And it's very difficult to make the patient admit the use of cocaine. And this is one of the biggest problems in the diagnosis. Also in history, there were some excellent patients, and we were wondering if the disease of Sigmund Freud was oral cancer or cocaine-induced lesion. We don't have any answer at the moment, but try to think to a patient that was treated in 1920 for an oral cancer, treated without the instrument and the cure that you have today, and that he was surviving for almost 20 years. And it would be interesting to look at the slide of the histological examination that he had, but it's very difficult to find it. However, if we go to the patient with the cocaine lesion and we examine the vascular changes like macroabscesses in the vascular wall, peritonitis, thrombogranulomatous vasculitis, leukocytoclastic vasculitis, and fibrinal necrosis, there is no statistical difference with GPA. But when you look at the extravascular changes like single multinucleated giant cells or granuloma, microscopic foci of deeply located necrosis, there are only in GPA. So regarding histopathologic findings, we say that CMDL and GPA share similar histologic manifestation, but stromal granulomas and with giant cells and microabscesses and deeply located necrosis exclude CMDL. And then the apoptosis assay, if it's positive, generally is a patient that is using cocaine. We were studying this, we were evaluating the intrinsic and extrinsic pathways of apoptosis, and we're studying in patient CMDL, in patient with GPA, with polyposis, nasal polyposis, and healthy patient. And we found that the caspase 3 and 9 only in cocaine patient, and the caspase 8 was negative in all the patient. So the intrinsic pathway is activated, and this is why we are saying that with the tunnel assay we can make a diagnosis with the CMDL. Regarding the serologic features, we know that ANCA is a family of antibodies directed against the granular component in the neutrophil cytoplasm. The typical ANCA related to GPA are directed against protein I3 in the adsorophil granules, the PR3 ANCA. This yields a fine cytoplasmic staining by indirect immunofluorescence, that is the C ANCA. The detection of PR3 ANCA by ELISA and C ANCA by indirect immunofluorescence can be used for diagnostic purposes, as it will be positive in 85 to 90% of GPA patients. PR3 C ANCA are highly specific in GPA. They are present early in the course of the disease, and a sensibility of 88%, a specificity of 95%, and is considered to have a positivity in systemic GPA 95% and in localized GPA in 50% of patients. And CMDL may be frequent ANCA positive, but they are HNE ANCA, are frequent in CMDL, but not in other autoimmune diseases, including classic ANCA-associated vasculitis. So the reason why we found the positivity with the PR3 ANCA in cocaine patient was the extract was not really pure, and in the PR3 extract sometimes there was also elastasis. Regarding the pathogenesis, it's very difficult today to understand why this patient developed this important destruction. We think to vasoconstriction, irritant effects of the adulterant, traumatic effect, recurrent nasal infection, epistaxis, crusting, apoptosis. But this happened in all patients, and not all the patients develop such a destructive lesions. So we start thinking that there might be a predisposing genetic background. And the genetic predisposition related to the response to reactive oxygen species, apoptosis, autophagy, and or tissue regeneration has a role in the establishment of CMDL phenotype. And we analyze the gene expression both in cell lines of nasal mucosa exposed to cocaine and in CMDL patients to determine whether genetic predisposition might cause such lesions. Rare variants of HRAS genes were searched in patients with CMDL using exome sequencing and bioinformatics. And 11 cocaine abusers with CMDL underwent exome sequences. 12 genes that were significantly enriched in the burden test and present in 10 patients were identified. And the analysis of these genes revealed their involvement in apoptosis, tissues homeostasis, autophagy, and response to oxidative stress. So oxidative stress and rare genetic alteration in the response to reactive oxygen species, apoptosis, autophagy, and tissue regeneration are plausible drivers of damages affecting nasal mucosa exposed to cocaine crystal and consequently the pathogenic mechanism behind CMDL. Few words just regarding the reconstruction. We know that statistically, 75 to 90% of cocaine abuser relapse within 1 year. So we need the workup for surgery. And we monthly follow up this patient with nasal endoscopy urine analysis, and we observe them for 12 months. If there is a cessation, the patient can decide if maintain a prosthesis and go for surgery. If there is still an abuse, medical therapy and prosthesis. And the follow-up restarts again in patient relapse in drug abuse. This is just an example of the history of patient that was using cocaine. You see here the destruction of the columella. So we put him a prosthesis just to help him from a statistical point of view. And after 2 years that he has stopped using cocaine, we decide to make surgery. There is every time a balance between aesthetic result and functional result, because is this nice? Not of course, it's not really nice, but it works and is much better than here. In conclusion, when we look at a patient with CMDL, we must remember that at endoscopy, we may find nasal crusting, nasal mucosa ulcer, extensive destruction, at the radiology extensive destruction, histopathology, they have vascular changes. They never have extravascular changes in our experience and the data published. They might have apoptosis. The serologic HNIANCA may be positive. And for the future, we are evaluating the genetic predisposition. Thank you very much and enjoy the meeting in Thessaloniki.